ਬਥੇਰਾ ਮਰ ਜਾਂਦਾ। The whole universal system is operated by the cooperative blended venture of two major forces. One is the active force, second is the supplementary force, which we see. The intellectual exposition, the physical executions, and also the output of the person's mental sturdity, will, and executive desire, all of these things are what we call human resources now, and things of the active resourceful energies of the visible universe. And the supplementary forces are like magnetism, the electromagnetic force, gravity, etc. And these sentient and insentient forces are governed by a super sentient force, and the super sentient force, it activates each and every part and parcel of the universe, being sentient and insentient. And how we have to start the study of temples, we have to study about the force which is known as a divinity. Even though magnetism, electricity, gravity, all of these forces are universal and ubiquitous, the process of pulling their nature, if electricity is everywhere, that cannot just create an apparatus to function. That needs a proper method by which it must be potentially driven, it must be stored. The devices of creating that energy or generating the energy from the etheric abundance or the cosmic abundance, generation. Second is the storage. Third thing is what we call the form of transformers, that which transmits and distributes all of these things. And fourth thing is the apparatus from which we are going to get the utilities of Jesus. So even those energies which are abundant in nature, that are hyperpotential in nature, they require a process of generation from the abundance, then a transmission, then storage and distribution. So likewise, the abundant divinity, that is totally unintelligible, inscrutable, ineffable, and far beyond the reach of human perceptibility, inference, and access. Those things by means of two processes. One is the ascending process, second is the descending process. Descending process is the avatarana, the process by which God simplifies himself so that he can be accessible to the mundane citizens of this globe. And ascending process is the process by which, by a preceptorial guidance, initiation, contemplation, spiritual disciplines, etc., a person qualifies himself even to understand the simplicity. The most simplified form of God itself, to understand that there must be a proper way of understanding which can be given only by an austere and disciplinary life. So it is known as Gacha Shishu Nyaya. Even it may be a smallest elephant, it does not mean that you can carry it into your armpit. So Gacha Shishu Nyaya, the smallest elephant, even those things are very much uncarryable and unimaginable for your transportation or your commodious grasp. Likewise, God's simplification itself, it requires more understanding, because God in his greatness, only few people, they have lost him. That was what Ambar, a great Vaishnava preceptor, used to say. The simplicity of the God, the oversimplicity of the God, has made lot of the people to forget and lose God rather than his magnanimity and greatness. So this simplified form of greatness, that must be understood only by an ascending process, which is a preceptorial touch, thought or guidance, whatever it may be. So let us start with the idea of understanding temple as a center of spiritual charge, a center of divine abundance, distributive abundance. What is the difference between abundance and distributive abundance? Abundance is totally, it is in copious scale, which is inaccessible to most of the people with the limited scale of operations. Distributive abundance is, that is also perennial, inexhaustible, but that has an additional mechanism by which it is accepting its nature to be distributable, attendable, accessible, admirable, digestible to all of the members of the religious society. So that is the greatness of temple, and that is how we have to start the kindergarten course for temple. So this temple is known as the abode of God. There are three things which you have to say. like center, abode and temple. Center is an operative institution and abode is a residential status, and temple is defined as a place where there is abundance in energy, inexhaustibility energy and distributism in energy, where there is an abundant energy which is inexhaustible as well as easily accessible, distributable to the people. That is known as temple. So that must be purna, that must be complete, that must be consummate, that must be eternal, that must be inexhaustible, and that must be distributive, and that must be a hope and scope of utilitarian services for the believers, accessories, components and dependents. It must be a temple. So let us start with the idea of understanding the temple and the sacred nature of the temple. You know that resources, they are known as nidhis. There are different types of wealth. We used to call it as five major schools of thought of wealth, Plutonics. The first thing is the token wealth, which we are having in the form of currency. Second thing is reference wealth, which we are having in the form of gold or some reserves. And third thing is what we call commodity wealth in the form of food, grains and other things. Fourth is subtle wealth in the form of satisfaction, contentment, harmony, etc. Fifth thing is known as real wealth, which is nothing but the manifestations of the gracious shower of benedictions of God, which comes in the form of various things, which is known as the real wealth. This is the study of wealth. So this is known as nidhi. What is nidhi? Nidhi is the grace of God. All the other things are aupacharika. Mukhya vritti means that which specifically that denotes the grace, that has the qualification to be designated as nidhi, wealth. And whatever we call as wealth, as they are bestowed by God, as they are nothing but the shower of God, nothing but the wish of God that should have them, those things are known as nidhis. So the grace of God is the primary element, other things are the derivatives. So that is known as nidhi. Grace of God is known as nidhi. And the area or the place or the substratum where we can get the energy charge, that is known as sannidhi. And there the establishment of that divinity, the gracious bounty, is known as sannidhya. So nidhi is resources. It may start with any type of purusha getting their own physical instincts satiated, their own quenches in material desires, being rudimentarily gifted, or it may be knowledge oriented, it may be emancipation oriented, it may be service orientation in here or even in the divine realm it may be. So all of these things, irrespective of the status or gravity of the divinity inside, everything is said to be the contribution of a temple. All purusharthas are given there. Sannidhya is the process of installation of that inhaustible, inexhaustible energy as specified and prescribed by himself. If you want to control an elephant, a controlled elephant, it hands over the chain to the person who controls so that he can tie the elephant with that. So God, out of his clemential touch towards the enhancement of the binded souls who are entering into the untold miserable cycles of birth, he himself, he has revealed the scriptures, the methodologies of worship. He revealed both of these things, Aradhana and Anushtana. How to take care of yourself, how to qualify yourself is Anushtana. How to take care of me in this form is known as Aradhana. So God has given these two major principles of governing his own self as well as the Supreme Self. So temple is a charge of divinity, and Sannidhya is installation of the divine resources, whereas nidhi is the grace of God. This is the first preliminary education about all temples. Then the second classification. These type of energies, they are governed by four major factors or four major steps. First thing, pratishtha. Second thing is aradhana. Third thing is acharya. Fourth thing is abhimanika. These four things are the major tools by which the receptivity from the temple's bounty or the gracious abundance can be instilled. First is pratishtha, the process of installation by mantras, by the rules that have been revealed by, manifested by the Mahabhuta, the God himself. And second is aradhana, even though it has been well installed. The Nitya, Naimittika, Utsavas, that is the festivities, celebrities, and various other functional systems of the temple that must be flawless, complete, systematic, and sincerely, loyally done by the authorities. That is Aradhana. And the person's life, that is the persons who are handling the idol, handling the divine form of God, their personal life of purity and austerity and transcendentality in the means of penance, contemplation, then Acharya Bhakti, all of these qualities, they enhance the status, the sannidhya of the temple. And Abhimanika, one third of the responsibility of making the temple serene, pure, sanctified lies in the administration of the devotees. One third with the Raja or the administrating system. There are three types of ruling systems. One is the direct ruling system, that is the rule of Agama. Second is the ruling system of the government, which rules the board of endowment, etc. Third is the ruling system which is adopted by the loyal devotees who flood or throng for various desires and their fructifications. So this Abhimanika, the contribution, each and every person who is attending a temple, they are getting into only their rights, not duties. Right of a person is no doubt to milk something from God, and no doubt his duty towards contribution. At least there are two types of contributions. One, self-perfection. We must be perfect. Second is to watch others' perfection and report it to the concerned authority and see that integrally we can contribute something for the serenity and development of the temple at all. So these four major forces are there. One third responsibility we people we are having. Lot of film fans association are there. Lot of people, they are going to see the heroes movie separately. But having understood the common interest towards a committed person, whether that is useful or useless, immediately they form a fans club, whether there are benefits or not. Likewise, a devotee is pertaining to some temple, they must have a common platform to contribute, to suggest, to demand, and even sometimes protest when the administration is against the rules that are framed by God. So this is how we have to manage a temple. There are innumerable, temple means there are lot of temples. And Soundarajan Swami has been narrating all of the temples. Temples of pre-Incan civilization, Hankan civilization, Sumerian, Mesopotamian, Harappa civilization, different temples they used to exist, and different countries they have different types of temples. Their temples are different from our temples. Their temples are just congregation centers and community halls. Just center of worship. This type of installation, pratishtha, is not there in their temple. Because there are two types of temples and forms of God which I am going to deal later. So their temples are just assembly, and our temple, it has sanctity. There are a lot of other principles like purity, integrity, harmony, everything is common to all temples. Temple is a center where a person must focus on something. For example, you might have seen the Dobri camera wherein by the person will close himself with a black cloth and he will focus on the object for photography before the advent of these modern Aeriflex and other cameras. Likewise, the total focus, forgetting everything, in our physical mode, in our domestic, we may be totally harassed and pestered by various other people in the form of our relations or form of thoughts inside even. So at this time, we want a separate place, a separate mode and atmosphere, which is given by a temple. So it is a center for our meditation, our discussion, our self-realization, etc. So it is meant for various people to collect themselves together for a common purpose. That is, you know that lot of the centers were training forces for military, and lot of the temples were different centers for martial arts, just as it is there in China and other areas. So the utmost benefit, Paramaprayojana and Sarvottamatva in temples is only with our culture, our agamas. And irrespective of the agama being the various schools of thought and various systems of worship, our agamas and our temples are said to be utmost in nature, Sarvottama, Utkrishta. It does not mean that the other things are adhama, it may be uttama, but our thing is Sarvottama. This is what I want to very recently distinguish. So in this manner, in our temples, we have to take care of only our temples. Our temples, there is the God's self-installed structure, that is Svayam Vyakta, invocative, that is Saiddha or Arsha, where rishis, they have contemplated and they have brought the God and installed for the betterment of the future society. Pauranika, that which is time immemorial worshipped by the lineage of kings and seers. And Abhimanika, that which is installed by people out of their love and devotion towards the God in villages and various other centers. So likewise, we have lot of other worship centers. Now I am going to take only few points to put the most clearest idea about the Vedas and temples. Very simply I want to put and conclude this session. Number one, temples. Temple, regarding temple, we have lot of opinions. Somebody said that God has no name, form and abode. He has no form. Why to give name? He has no name and form. Where is his abode? So it is not existing. It is just a human invention. Second school of thought is, it is totally not against the temple system, but it thinks that it is for the beginners. It is for the beginners to catch a form and to meditate and go to a temple. It is a disciplinary formation and it has no purpose at all. So it is just a beginner. And third type of people are totally iconoclasts, against this, like they used to call us as kafirs. So this type of system also that exists. So we want to put some light. God has name, form and abode. The scriptures that say that God is nameless, formless and abodeless means He is not having such a name which is being given by somebody else. All names are His name. He is not having a special name for Himself. Everything is His. He is not having any form means He is not having such a form which is composed of the five elements. Out of His own wish. Somebody told at Canada, how can we scientifically or logically prove that God is having body or form? Then I told that if you say that God has no form, from that same word we can derive that He has form. If you say that, if I am saying that this tumbler does not exist, then I have to write the qualities of this tumbler and I must negate that. If Chaturvedi has not come, means the person named Chaturvedi of this figure and all of these other things, changeable things are like this, robes and other things are changeable. All unchangeable phenomena can be totally derived in a paper and we can negate that. Chaturvedi has not come, means Chaturvedi aged, born for, residing at, all of these things you have put, such a person has not come. So it is known as a descriptive negation. Likewise, if you say that God has no form, you are giving descriptive negation. What is it? God is not having form. What is a form? Form is composed of five elements. The form is an output of karma. Form is given by somebody else. This form is a substratum for melancholy and eudaimonia, that is sorrow and happiness. This form is totally unirascible. We are getting a successful rate of births perpetually. So this is the definition for body or sharira. Sharira is made up of five elements. It is perishable, it is given by somebody, it is a karmic grant and it is perpetual, endless. So you write all of these things and negate. God is not having a form which is made up of five elements, not having a form which is karmic output or grant. He is not having such a form which is subjecting to perpetual births and deaths. All of these things will come, which will directly give that God is having such a form which is not composed of five elements, which is not karmically bounded, which is not granted by somebody else. It gives that God is having a form composed of five transcendental elements, pancha operation maya sharira, parameshti puma nivritti, vishwanama, vishwasharvanama, pancha operation maya akrata divya mangala shakra, sharira vishita soshati, agamas and shastras. Parameshti, Puman, Nivritti, Vishwa, Sarvanama, Panchoparishanmaya, Aprakrita, Divya, Mangala, Vigraha, Vishishtha. So God is having such a form which is above karmic, which can release us from karmic bondage, which is taken out of His Svechagrihita Sharira, which is not given by somebody else. So even if you negate the form of the God, the negation is a descriptive negation, which is nothing but giving a different type of body, which is in the Shastras, which is special for God Himself, which is not found elsewhere else. So God is having name, form, so He is having also abode, which is His choice. His choice is manifested through our wish, through the scriptures, through the desire and potential will of the elite and sacred personalities of our land. If it is your wish, if it is the will of sages, seers and scholars, if it is the command of the scriptures, all of these things are nothing but the manifestations of the wish of God. This is nothing but the Sankalpa Avatara of God, which is exhibiting different forms through different personalities. So God is having name, form and abode, and all of these things are Janma Karma Chame Divyam. My form, my manifestations and my deeds, they are all divya, they are all transcendental, they are all surpassing your normal thoughts. As your things cannot compromise or compete with us, or they are totally different from each other, you cannot say that I could not have it. I am having the same things, but in a different level of gravity, in a level of transcendentality which is not binding all of these murky things that you are having. So this is the first thing. And second thing is what they call as beginners. They used to call it as beginners. Worshipping a form of God or worshipping a temple, all of these things are beginners. It is not like that. In Vaishnava Sampradaya, they used to say that Archayam Paratva Buddhi Vaishnava Vailakshanyam. The greatest attribute of a true Vaishnava is The simplest form of that is in the form of idol. Assumed that form for us. The person who loves that simplest form is to be a true Vaishnava. The God who is feeding everybody, he assumes the form of an idol and he is asking for demanding for feed. The God who is festively supporting all of our grandeur and glory, he is demanding us to conduct his festivals. And he has wrapped the cloth of the firmament to the whole earth and other planetary systems, and he is asking for the cloths and other decorations. He has embraced the world with resources, and we are asked to embellish his structure with various other garlands and other divine ornaments. So God, out of his mercy, just as a person who is in over extremity of something, he will select for something else in the contrary. So God is always Swadhina and Swatantra, and due to his Nirankusha Swatantriya, absolute sovereignty, God developed a taste towards Paradhinatva, subservience, and that he has exhibited towards a glorious person, his total devotees, committed loyal personalities. Through them he has quenched his thirst or desire in the forms of idols. So understanding the simplicity as well as the supremacy and greatness blended here in the form of Archavatara, we can understand that it is not for the beginners. Even at the level of ad infinitum or ultimatum, one has to love the Archavatara, because the Vibhavavatara is the simple form of God, and Archavatara is the simpler form of God, and Acharyavatara is the simplest form of God, wherein by we can talk, we can speak, we can communicate, it is interactive. So there were several levels of God, out of which Archavatara is very much handleable. It has been told in the Vedas also, Ato yad daru pravate sindhopare apurusham. Even in Vedas, this is a shloka, this is a sutta which mentions about Puri Jagannatha temple. And you know the famous Arayi Kane Vigate Girim Gacha. This mentions Trivengada Mudaya or Srinivasa. Likewise, Hrithayam tat vijaniyat tasyaya tanam mahat. There are two interpretations. This Hrithaya, your heart, is said to be Ayatanam Mahat, big temple for God, or great temple for God. Then somebody interpreted it is a great temple for God, and this temple are very simple temples. The person who dwells inside, that is the immanent God, who is seated in your heart, that is Mahad Ayatana, a great temple. And somebody interpreted as that is Mahad Ayatana, and these things are Ayatanas, these things are simpler temples. Whereas our people, they just commented like, this is Mahadayatana, who dwells inside you, but who cannot be seen, who cannot be enjoyed, whose companionship cannot be rejoiced. He is Mahadayatana, and the person who is visible in the form of idols in the temple, that is Mahatarayatana, and the Acharyas who are in the form of bounteous mercy and wisdom, who showers their knowledge for the emancipation from our sins and from our bondages, they are known as Mahatamayatana. So instead of considering it as Mahat and Amahat, our people qualified it as to be Mahat, Mahattara and Mahattama. So Vedas, even we can quote thousands of stanzas from Vedas which can give the greatness of the temple seating or the abode manifestation of God. Kalyana tamam rupam aham pashyami. Even that Kalyana rupam, Kalyana taram rupam, Kalyana tamam rupam, that was in Ishavasha Upanishad, that says that Kalyana rupam is the real form of God. Kalyana Taram Rupam is God descended, he became Kalyana Tara. He assumed the form of ideals, that is Kalyana Tama. Because the more we are benefited, when God resides in your heart, only few yogis, 100 yogis, they can understand. When God is there in the form of Vaikuntha Purusha, or Kshira Sagara Purusha, only 2 or 3 people can understand. If he is in the form of a glorious idol in a temple, lakhs of people can. So the more benefit is there, the Kalyana Tamatva is endorsed there for only the temples. Then kafirs, I want to give you a clear explanation on kafirs. The kafirs, they do not denote the Hindu system of worship at all. Because we have two forms of gods. One is the form of demigods, and one is the form of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The form of demigods, we cannot just go out it, because demigods are mortals. Demigods are mortals. So certainly they used to have a body which is originated, which is developed, which is perishable. So for demigods, having a body is not against the rules. It is known as theophysiology or theomorphology, which is a subject which deals with the nature of the body of God and the phenomenon of assumption of body by gods and demigods. What is the type of the body? It may be entirely different, but that is a body. So body assumed by supreme is out of his own desire, his own will. I have already told it is Ichcha Grihita Sharira, Aprakrita Sharira. So we cannot just disqualify it. So kafirs, this denote exclusively to those people who lived in the barbaric Arabian society, who worshipped different forms of God out of their imagination, out of their own imagination, out of superstition. Out of superstitious knowledge somebody have worshipped, out of supernal knowledge we have worshipped. So that type of Arabic society, they don't have three things. One is scripture, scriptural lineage of seers, and spiritual lineage through acharyas or preceptors. So that which is there followed by a scriptureless society, orderless society, lineageless society, initiationless society, that has been condemned by the so-called Arabic religions. And even the Bethlehem and Jerusalem religions of Judaism, as well as the pre-Jewish religion along with the Christianity, they also condemned. Their condemnation is only attributed to that society which existed there, where there is no principle, where there is no definition and description for the root cause of body assumption for the supreme as well as for demigods. So that is very much adaptable only to them, and we are not kafirs as described by them, because it is super. We have scriptures, we have principles, we have explanations. So their scriptures are their holy treatises. They enter the kafirs as those superstitious people, those who dwelt in their own communities at those period, which cannot be attributed by them. We must understand that our adoption of temples and vigraharadhana, iconography and temple architecture, installation technology and temple technology and worshipping methodology of our land is fully scientific and technical, and it cannot be attributed to type of superstitious entanglements as claimed by the so-called kafir brandation. So this is how I want to very clearly put. Now let us come to the power of God in the form of archa.
Mamiji, you will allow me to leave. I have doctor appointment.
Yeah, okay.
I just want to give you my publication. I'm a photographer.
The name of the power of God that pervades each and every structure, that radiates with each and every worshipper, that glorifies the person with bestowal of all essential and needed gifts, that power is known as Archi. In Vedas, that power is known as Archi. So that Archi is adopted by a Vigraha form, which is known as Archa Vigraha. And by a worshipping process by which that power is glorified and that is manifested more, that is renewed, is known as Archana. And a person who does, he is known as an Archaka. So this is the process of our spiritual lineage in temple administration. So Archi, Archa, Archana, Archa Vigraha, Archaka. This we have to understand, that is our greatness. Then we have to come to the Prayojana Dvika. What are the Prayojanas? What is Prayojana Dvika? Bhagavataha Prayojanam. Then Tatra Sevarthinam, Mantra Drashtunam, Bhaktajananam Prayojanam. What is the effect, or what is the fruit for the devotees? We can immediately say that is a place that should give comfort, that should give solace, that should give prosperity, that should give realization, starting from your disease eradication till divine bliss and realization. It can give all things. Starting from the fructification of our simplest requirements till getting divine bliss, it can give all benefits. Then comes the most critical question: what is the benefit of God in temples? Our benefits are very much obvious. What is the benefit for God? What he wants to do? You know that great people, you must have seen, now it has become very common. It has become very cheap also. Lot of other medical practitioners, they used to be available in lodges in all places. But those things are very much like a tenting process. Monthly, you must have seen the itinerary of lot of medical practitioners. First to the third, you will be Hyderabad. Fourth to sixth at Vijayawada. Seventh to Vishakhapatnam, like that. This thing is known as a transient itinerary. Likewise, God, who is ungraspable by our material means, And even those who cannot assimilate the scriptures and the guidelines given due to lack of proper language as well as technical skill as well as other committability or even lack of time to approach those things. So these all are various factors, they have elongated the distance between God and human being. So God himself, he installed some centers, some counseling centers, contact centers, branches in various places wherein by he can communicate with the people. So what is the prayojana means? Bhaktanam darshanam, bhaktanam paraspara darshanam, bhaktanam darshananda, bhaktanam paraspara darshananda, bhaktanam paraspara anandam drishtva bhagavato ananda, bhaktanam parasparyam drishtva bhagavadanandam drishtva bhagavadananda, bhaktanam paraspara anandam drishtva jarita bhagavadanandam drishtva jarita bhagavadanandam drishtva bhagavadananda. This is the purpose of temples. God, if everybody is there in their own houses and doing all of these things, there won't be mutual contact. If you are worshipping your God in your mind or in your house, if I am worshipping my God in my place, how there will be the contact between, integrity between devotees? Whenever the energy of devotion with various devotees, they are conglomerated at a common place, then it becomes synergy. Then independent type of worship is allergy, that is not energy. If you are worshipping within your own room, within your own God, that is known as allergy. That is not going to contribute anything further. The more you are united, the more you are integral, more it is spread, it becomes synergy. That synergy is possible only at a common place. That common place, this article, 100 devotees can meet. But it must have the equipments. The doctor's surgical equipments must be available in operation theater. If you just measure the dimension of the operation theater as 10 by 12 or something, if you provide the same doctor, the same dimension without the apparatus, it won't create the essential impact. So there must be a tool available. So it is not only a place, but also with a tool that is known as the installed, powerful God and his potential radiations. There, God to, number one, to federate all of the devotees and to see them and to be blissful, number one. Number two, on seeing mutually, all of the devotees, they will be blissful with each other. Number two. Number three, on seeing the mutual bliss between the share among the devotees, God is very happy. On seeing God is very happy, on seeing the mutual bliss, all the devotees are very happy. On seeing all the devotees very happy, on seeing the bliss of God, God is very, very, very happy. So he is pleased, he is blissful, he is eudaimonic, and he is tremendously enraptured by various stages of bliss that is acquired in temples. That is the purpose of temples to God. It is known as prayojana dvikar. Now let us come to the temple technology. Temple technology is science. Science is knowledge. When you put it into practice, you have understood that a temple has a divinity. It does not mean, or it is not sufficient enough to immediately create the technology. Technology must have a systematic procedure it follow. So mere science without technology, that cannot guide us. So now come to temple technology. It deals with the structure or the space. Then the dimensions. You know space, first we have to select a space. I have to say something, if you go to a hill station, on that altitude you will feel cool. The same place, somewhere else if you move towards a lower altitude, you will feel something sultry or you may feel hot. Both existing in the same plane, you experience different things. It is altitude variation. In the same earth, we are having America and we are having India. And to equate one unit of currency of America, we have to give 43 rupees of our currency. Both exist in the same globe. And in the same firmament, if you visit Pluto for 1 year, while you are coming back, you will be attending your great grandson's wedding ceremony. Because 1 year in that Pluto or Neptune, that is equal to 97 years here. So because of the difference of the distance between the axis and the orbit. So likewise, even though they exist in the same firmament, even though these countries exist in the same globe, even though the hill station and sultry station exist in the same platform, we experience different things. Likewise, temple may be constructed in the same plane. In the same plane or in the same street, you may be seeing a temple, a theater, a hospital, club, everything, etc. As it is constructed on the same plane, that is entirely different. That is known as specific spiritual gravity, SSG. A temple consists of, as soon as it is committed with a process of installation, it has a specific spiritual gravity. If you have to spend or lose 100 rupees outside, if it is contributed for a productive loss, it is known as Praya in Sanskrit. If you contribute that for the welfare of the temple or for the god, 1 rupee, that is equal to 100 rupees outside. If you want to suffer for 10 years, you need not suffer inside a temple. At least if you spend some time inside a temple for at least 1 week or 1 hour, that is equal to 1 year outside. So that has an equation. It is known as the law of crucial equation. It is known as the law of crucial equation or law of crucial equality. What is crucial equality? Something being essentially positioned in the same platform on the basis of the divinity radiation variation, the time spent, the amount of energy spent or resources that have been spent here, that equals to something greater in proportion or in ratio outside, which gives you more boosting or avoidance of loss and loss minimization, which I have explained yesterday. So that is the greatness of temple. So temple technology, that space, by means of natural gravity, it is known as ontological points. It is known as onto points, we used to say in science. That onto points, whenever it is selected for a temple, or inherently it has onto levels more due to the spiritual specific gravity that commands additional benefit, which distinguishes the area and its commonalism with the other areas. That is the greatness of temples. Then the second thing is dimensions as per Vastu. There are three shastras. For the space understanding, you have to go to one shastra. For the other thing, you have to go to one shastra. For the construction, we have to go to one shastra. That is known as Vastu. Vastu is known as space systemism science. It is known as space systemism science. How to handle a space is introduced in Vastu. That is elucidated in Vastu. So first is space. Second is Pratishtha, that is explained in Agama Shastra. And third thing is Shilpa, which is for Nirmana. So for a temple, there must be Vastu, Shilpa and Agama. And the conglomeration of these trilateral skills of Vastu Shastra, Shilpa Shastra and Agama Vijnana, that contributes a perfect temple which can withstand for thousands of years benefiting lakhs of people in their crores and crores of demands which they are tirelessly putting before the God. So this is how we have to explain the construction. The construction consists of the methodology. It has Garbhagraha, wherein it is known as the energy center, and the receptorial center, the festive center, the common center, conglomerative center, and the hilarity center, the vistara or the parikramana, which is meant for the sojourn. It is known as the sojourn or the orbit center, which is known as avarana or parikramana, which in Sanskrit known as Garbhagraha, Pradhamandapa, Mahamandapa, Utsavamandapa in the form of Vasanta Mandapa, Yaga Mandapa, Bhoga Mandapa, all of these mandapas, Pavitra Mandapa, Sahasrastambha Mandapa, different types of names are there available for them. So all of these various things are parts and parcels of the temple. Then the construction, the Nirmana Shastra, you know about Chalukya architecture, Pallava architecture, these and that, all of these things they have no sense at all. These things are the various depictions of their own styles. But anybody can handle any number of styles in architecture, being the basic frame. You can wear any number of pant or shirt in different designs, provided that they suit you. They are under the norms. There are some norms of Agama, the features contradicting which we have to embellish the temple with your architectural skill. Architecture must not just cross the boundaries of the stipulations of Shastras. And these architectures can be of three types. One is Aitihya, second is Chikna, and the third thing is Bimba. In Chinha, we used to depict symbols like Kamala, like Swastika, then Gaja, Kalpa Vriksha, all of these things are known as Mangala Chinhas. And second thing is Aitihya, it may be Amrita Matana, Gajendra Moksha, then Usha Kalyana, it may depict any number of historical or Puranic areas. And the other thing is Bimbas. Have the Bimbas of either kings, the patronages, or the other various people, worshipable, laudable personalities, transcendental skiers and scholars of Sampradayas. It may have the Maharishis, it may have even the Devatas, Apsaras, Kinnara, Kimpurusha, etc. So different types of studies of this energy, they have resulted. So the Vedas, they dealt with the energy that is to be studied, and Agamas, how to energize it in the form of an embodiment title that has been read in Agamas. then the depiction of various things that is there in Puranas, the Stotras, everything is contained in Puranas. Study of all of other things in the form of literature, the Bhakti literature, that is a historical study, history that encompasses the study of a temple and various persons' rule. It is very much important for contemporary understanding and future administration. So starting from the Vedas, the Shastras and Puranas, archaeology to study the ruins, the preserved ruins are studied in museology, then epigraphy that deals with the study of the inscriptions and the informations from them, and various other sciences that have emanated from that, architecture, agamas, I have already told many number of them. So this type of understanding is meant for various people to imbibe. What is the purpose of God? To attract more person. So he has created sweet prasada. It is known as each and every part and parcel of your body requires a specific taste. The eye requires good sight. It requires good music. The auditive tools, they require good music. The taste buds, they demand good sumptuous food. So each and everything, pleasure for sight and the mellifluidity for music and taste for the taste buds and various space for your common sitting and quiet understanding or meditation. So it has lot of other various things. So God wanted to imbibe various things. So there are two things which I want to say. Somebody told why there are big spaces in temples. At least for getting good air, at least for spending their loneliness, there will be some people entering inside the temple. If there are Shilpa Shastras of varieties, it may be either Shringara, Aitihya or Puranika, if there are a lot of Shilpas, at least for seeing that Shilpa, somebody will enter inside the temple. And if prasada is given, at least for that there will be entering some people. Devadasis, good dancers and musicians were occupied in the temple and the system was misadopted and it was collapsed also. So these type of things, at least for seeing the dance and music, so your interest in performing arts, fine arts, good food, space, solace, loneliness, comfort, various instincts of human needs are understood by God, and to pull each and every person, at least for the sake of their material immediate benefits to be quenched, let them be brought inside. What is the benefit? God is having a diary in which he records each and everybody's punya, virtuous deeds. And he not only records the real punya, he also qualifies something as punya out of his mercy and he records in the notebook. Those records are of three types. He is having three diaries. One is Anushangika diary, second is Prasangika diary, third is Yadruchika diary. Even if you accidentally do something, even you do something for a different purpose, even you do something without desire of the same purpose, something accidentally, doing something for a different purpose, doing something not tasked or focused on this purpose, all of these things, if it is something connected with God, God just writes in his diary that yes, you have done to that. If you are just, it is told that if you are chasing your cow which has run inside a temple, God writes, you have done your pradakshina to my temple, it is punya, so you will be given good births, you will be given good prosperity, good progeny. So God in his diary, as he is very desirous. So we used to say a very great example which is very common in household life. If we don't like somebody, even though if they don't commit mistakes, we are doing two things. One, we will do some mistakes and we will put the blame on them. Number two, we will see that wherever they do small mistakes, we will try to blow, and whatever they do, we will try to convert it to or describe it into mistakes. Because of the hatredness. Like that, the God who loves us more, wherever we do small goodness, God wants to blow it as a very good, great deed that we have done, as well as even though we did normal things that are endorsed, those things are explained, are felt by God as goodness, and God sees each and every moment where he can inscribe in his note or diary about your goodness so that you can be emancipated or at least enhanced in your future births. So God, having created mass space, this architectural skill with prasadams, with good chance, with music and dance, he expects each and every person, even persons who are totally abandoned in these operations, God comes in the form of Utsava. In the form of Utsava, the Utsava idol, that is a mobile idol, he visits each and every village, so that those who are physically incapable, mentally incapable, spiritually incapable are against God, even though they could not see them, God sees them and sees that they are benefited. So being seen by God is real benefit, seeing God is not benefit. So even though the atheists, skeptics, are persons immersed in material moorings, even though they are not interested in seeing God, God comes in the form of Utsava Parikramana to villages, and within the villages or even God goes to Samudra Snana, etc. for the purpose of consecrating the area, seeing those who have not seen Him, those who want to, do not want to see Him, those who are against seeing Him, even those people, they are radiated by the vision of God. Such much is the greatness of temples and ideas, without understanding which we must not simply say that these things are for the beginners and these things are useless and these things are human imagination. It is not so. It is a very great sin. Now let us conclude the session with temple administration. Now I have told about all the essentials of this technology, how to utilize the technology of the temple for the welfare of the people. And let us come to temple administration. Temple must have some sort of freedom from three nuisances which are there now. One is noise nuisance. Everywhere, you see, somebody told, when I asked if you are peace lover, if you want some solace or peace or some mental comfort, why can't you go to your temple and sit? And the person answered very clearly, except in temple, I get that everywhere. Because temple has become an abode of all noises. Sartika shouts there, then these people, they shout, bringing children, doing all sorts of noise. We must learn from these Christian monasteries, the churches and the mosques, how silence is maintained. Silence is not absolute silence, just as the silence in graveyard. We don't want that silence. Silence is not hearing anything unwanted or unconnected except that type of noise, voice or melody that would arise from that area. Temple is only meant for divine thought and exposition. That may be in the form of a divine song, that may be in the form of divine chanting, that may be in the form of divine recitation of the Vedas or Archana, whatever they may be doing in the form of these sacerdotal rites and rituals of the temple. Apart from that, no other sound should be heard in temples. So this noise pollution is very much in temples. Certainly you have to take good action, otherwise it will become just worse than market. Even markets are becoming civilized now. Even the fish market is becoming civilized. They are just showing signs and gesticulations and purchasing fishes. That has gone out. The temple we are still mastering and still we are maintaining that area. The second thing is cleanliness. Temple has no cleanliness, etc. Temple is, somebody told that one temple there they have invited for sandblast or for some temple structure, the pillar structure, rejuvenation or renovation, they were undergoing some process. And one person told that in our temple we don't want any such process for our pillars, because whenever we eat the prasadam we used to just wipe it up with the pillars, and by the oil that is there in Pulihodara and ghee in Sakra Pongal, etc., all of the pillars are sufficiently greasy and they are glittering. So we don't want any process of either purification or renovation. Is this a method of worship? Cleanliness must be there. Temple must have 1000 times hajitsi. First of all, it is purity. First of all, it must start with purity, then with the serenity, then only third it comes to sanctity, then only we can get divinity. What is purity? Purity is material perfection. See, if this is very much well furnished and then very well maintained, orderly place, that is known as purity. Serenity is atmospheric coherence. The atmospheric coherence must be there, wear a proper uniform, proper row must be there, be quiet. These things are contributing for the serenity. Then only by mantras and other things there will be sanctity. If there is a purity in the temple surface, then if there is serenity which is administered by the innumerable devotees, if there is sanctity which is authorized by the archakas and other peoples in principle, then only we can claim for divinity. So all of these things are interrelated and locked. This is how we have to create. Third thing is beggar's menace. Somebody they criticize even, inside is the embodiment of riches. And lot of people in cars, all rich people are going inside. But the threshold is occupied by all beggars. So, what is the reason for this? So, this is how they have to see this paradox. So, what we have to do is, we must not encourage these things also. Dana is entirely different from Bhiksha. We must see where people are incapable. They must be installed. These things are the work of a government. They must be installed somewhere else. There must be some proper care home. Most of the people, they are just giving their earnings or their collections for meager interest. Most of the beggars in the temple, and they can, even if you say that I have 1000 rupees and no change at all, immediately they can give you a change. And number two, they are lending outside for a negligible interest. See, this is not a real charity. No God will be pleased at all. Encouraging such people is encouraging poverty or encouraging sluggardishness, which will result in the form of your sluggardishness, and your unorganized charity will result in total turmoil gradually, and it is not a charity at all. There are two ideas. We must see that those people are totally dismantled from temples, and if they are so, they must be given a proper shelter, and somebody, anybody interested in donating something for their marriage day or birthday, they can go there and do that. Those people, they can come for worship and other things. That is a little different. Number two, instead of these things, famous NGOs, established NGOs, growing NGOs, they can have their stalls before the temples. Disaster relief, knowledge dissemination, all of these various things are there. Those who are doing social services and spiritual services, the NGOs, they can have their stalls with the depiction through brochures and other photos, and they can give some money. These people really interested in doing something to a society, they can contribute something for those people, for at least some social development. So these three menaces are to be removed. And the next thing is very simply, I want to put, a temple must teach you discipline. It must create inside you harmony and commitment. It must give you education. It must give you mind and availability for meditation. So education means giving knowledge about the temple. You are going to a temple for 10 years, you are not knowing anything about the temple. Whereas Krishnamacharya, he will tell the stories, he is over extreme. If somebody, most of the people at Srirangam, they don't. So it must be a center of meditation, center of religious and spiritual education. It must be also a center for discipline. And also it must be a center for developing harmony and commitment between the devotees. Let me come to the conclusion statement by saying something about sin share. What is sin share? It is a share in sin. Whatever the government is doing, we are sharing it. Whatever we are doing, the government is sharing it. It's known as sin share. So there is a place. There is property, there is priesthood. There are three P's in a temple. How to utilize that place? Why we are just losing the place without anything? We can conduct a lot of research, seminars, conferences, training things. How to use the surface of temple? Each and every temple is having innumerable property records. That must be a court of religious justice, and all of these things must be taken to a separate court as the, because most of the property swallowers are either the ruling parties, of the ruling parties, or binamis of the ruling parties. How they can enact only a rule that is against their own, this thing, it is just like digging their own grave. So they won't do that. So by protest we have to see that there is a court of religious justice, and the properties are meant for not even the temple but also for the society. Crores and crores of these things are there. How to maintain the priesthood by training each and everybody. If the worshipper, if he loses faith, that is okay. And if person who organizes the worship, the priest, if he loses the faith and if he is just perfectly doing these things, then how there can be sanctity in that, and how we can get benefits. So whatever we are getting in the form of benefits are not the benefits from the temple. The benefits that we have already shown in our previous births are accidental, coincidental relations between our going to temple and getting benefits. Because really it is not in such a manner in which it must be. So the place maintenance, property maintenance, and priesthood maintenance must be authored by all of you. You are willing to milk benefits from the temple. Are not interested in meeting these three things, then whatever you get, it will be insufficient or inefficient. It will be even adverse to you. For the sin of non-commitance towards temple development and sustenance or maintenance, you will be punished by God. It is a warning given by the scriptures themselves. So I wish that the temple science must be imparted, the temple technology must be properly practiced, and the temple administration must be regulated in the society. Temple is the real fort of a country. Temple is the real military strength of the country. Now we are creating such a temple in which we have to lock it and we have to guard. If it is really maintained in its schedule, that temple is going to be the fortress of the land. It is going to be the missile of our land. It is going to be, due to that only somebody asked the question. You are having a lot of powerful temples. Thousands of people are going. When Muslims invaded and when they totally dismantled and demolished their temples and idols, what your gods and what your scriptural practices they have been doing. I told that everything was disorganized. Disorganized. Even though if there is energy, if it is disorganized, it is not going to. I am having a pistol with bullets, but the pistol is separated into five forms. The holster is here, the trigger is here, that is here, bullets are kept somewhere else, and you are in the second room. How it will happen? So all the things are disorganized. Organized structure of various components of spiritual strength must be united. I wish that relations must come, and we have to continuously engage in such seminars. At least we should organize in temples. Tirupati Devasthanam should conduct this type of seminar, free seminars and classes daily to their wealth and to their place availability, they have to do. And also each and every temple where people come, even though they are Sinani, Jaju people, they are having their own temple. Very simply in India, in the each and every language, they must be given these two ideas. What are your rights from the temple and how to claim your rights? What are your duties to the temple and how to do within your limited schedule or your capable schedule? I wish that such a day would come. And we must be the really resourceful people for bringing that dawn in the society. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.